Hello, I'm David. I'm one of the lecturers in the Maths Learning Centre at the University of Adelaide, and this is the Rough and Ready lecture about integration. I'm going to talk about what integration is, what I think it is, and some of the first ideas about how you could attempt to figure out what it means, and then I'll talk about some techniques of doing it. I might not get to all of them in this lecture, so there might be a second lecture after this. If that happens, I will put a link to it nearby to this one so you can find it. Okay, so integration is a kind of calculus. Which literally means stone, and it's to do with the stones they used to calculate with in ancient Greece, well, ancient Europe anyway. The other kind of calculus is differentiation. It turns out that differentiation and integration are linked, and it will be useful to know some things about differentiation if you want to do integration. So if you haven't seen that before, I recommend going and finding something, for example, my earlier videos about differentiation and looking that up first. But the beginning of integration doesn't require derivatives to understand. Okay. And the beginning of integration, I begin with averages. So if I had a number of people like this, and I calculated, and they're all saying a number, so maybe it's the number of slices of pizza they ate at a party. And if I thought about the average of what these numbers are, one way of thinking about that is to try and rearrange all these numbers so that they were more evenly spread. So this person's got one. This person's got two. This person's got six. One, two, three, four, five, six. This person doesn't have any. This person has four. And this person has five. They're not all the same size, but this is what I had access to here in the lecture theatre. Okay, so I could evenly spread them a little better. So some of this could go over here. This could go here. This could go here. Go like that. There we go. And now everybody has the same. And that same number that everybody has when I share them all out evenly is the average. So the average number of, what did I say there were, pizza slices, is three. Because the other way of dealing with that is to add them all up and share them out, right? So we have one lot of six, two lots of sixes, and three lots of six, like that. And so when I share them all out one at a time, I get three each. So you add them all up and divide by how many there are, and that's how you normally do an average. So what I'm going to be interested in is in that first bit there, where we added them all up. So I'm just going to put them back again. And I can, the other way I can imagine adding them all up is to do it, you know, so like a running total. So there's three here, and now there's nine, and now there's still nine, and now there's 10. Just a second. Now there's 9 plus 4 is 13. And now there's 18 of them. and then I would spread them all out if I wanted to do an average. But what I'm going to be interested in today, because that's what integrals are about, is that total as I move along from one side to the other. Okay, so that's the beginning. That's what averages are about. Okay, I'm not going to write anything on my sheet. When I get to the to sort of talking about what an integral is, I'll write it down. Okay, and that works perfectly well even if you haven't got positive numbers, okay? So your numbers might be, for example, what temperature would you like on a winter's day? So I'm going to be talking to some people who live in a cold climate, so they're okay with cold temperatures, and some of them are you know, high or low. So these people have opinions about what is a good temperature for a snowy winter's day. And I'm going to add them all up as well. I'm going to try and figure out what the average temperature is, but before I do that, I'm going to have to add up all the temperatures and spread them more evenly among the people. So add them all up and divide by how many there are. Now I have, 20 people here. And I'm going to add up all their numbers. But I'm going to do it in a special way. I'm going to look as the people walk past and write down what I see. Okay, so here they come. Just a second. I will going to have to write something down. So, e.g., sort of a... total of numbers people say. Okay. Okay, so the first person says one. And the second, both of those people say five. So I can have two lots of five. Well, or I can have five times two. Beautiful. And then I've got three twos, so I can have two times three. And I've got a zero. And then I've got, one, two, three, four minus twos. It's four. I've got one, two, three fours. And I've got a three. And I've got a minus one. And I've got three fives. And I've got another three. And that's the end of them. And so whatever the total is what that adds up to. And just for the purposes of making this look nice, now, there's nothing stopping the numbers happening more than once. That's okay. So I end up with, what do I get? I get a total of 1 plus 10 plus 6 plus 0 minus 8 plus 12 plus 3 minus 1, plus 15, plus 3. So 11, 17, 9, 21, 24, 23, 38, 41. Okay, so that's the total. So what I did there is I looked ahead to see how many had the same number, and I multiplied how many had that number what number by how many had that number, and I was able to add up the total. And I could have looked across the whole line and literally counted all the fives and noticed that there were five lots of five, and I could have done it that way. But for the purposes of today's story, I'm imagining just only being able to see the next few in order to be able to do this. Okay, so that's the total of numbers people say. And I'm going to draw some of this illustration here. This one says one. 5, 5, 2, and then there's like another person coming right off the edge of the page, and they're walking this way. Okay, that's the illustration, just so that the people reading this who don't see the picture can look at it. Okay, and so that's an idea there. Now, integration, as I said earlier, is a kind of calculus, and calculus is a thing you do to functions. And at the moment, we sort of have a function that goes from which number you are in the list to what number you say. So person number one said one, and person number two said five, and person number three said five, and person number four said two. And so where you are in the list produces a number, and that's a function just as much as anything else is. But we're used to functions being able to take in any number, not just whole numbers, and spit out numbers as well. And so we'd like a way of doing some sense of a running total, for a function that takes on all sorts of different values at all these decimal places. And the way we're going to do it is we're going to think about this thing here. So all of these were the actual function values. Like that, they were the function values, these numbers here. And these numbers here were how many people in the line after this point had that number. So there was one person, then there were two people, then there were three people, and so on. And so that's how I'm going to conceptualize my sum for functions. What I'm going to do is if I have a function and it's a certain number for a certain amount of space, it's going to be, that's how I'm going to figure it out. And I'll just do an example. E.g. These are my x's. Okay, and maybe my function is equal to 2 at all of these places, and then it's 3 here, and it's minus 1 at all of these places, and then it's 5 up to this spot here at 7. And it doesn't have to switch over at the whole numbers, but I'm just pointing something out. So if I have a function that, and I'm imagining that these twos are not just what they are at these places, that every function value along here is 2. And every one of these points has a function value that I could calculate, and they're all 3. And every one of these points has a function value, and they're all minus 1. And every one of these points has a function value, and they're all 5. Then I could imagine the total, some sort of total across this length, 0 to 7, across x from 0 to 7 would be, well, I've got the number 2, which has got a width of 2, the number 3 has a width of 1, the number minus 1 has a width of 3, and the number 5 has a width of 1. Okay, that's the idea. So these are the function values here. And these are the spaces in which it has those function values. And that's how I'm going to do it. It's kind of called a weighted total. So each number is being included based on more if there's more space that's equal to that number. So this function is equal to minus 1 for a span of 3 units, and so that minus 1 is going to count for 3. But it's only equal to 5 for a space of 1 unit, so that's only going to count for 1. And that's how this weighted total's going to work. And that's what the integral is. It's going to be a weighted total of the function values, and each function value is going to be counted a number of times. It's going to be counted based on the width of the interval that has that function value. Okay? I'm not going to write that down yet. That's just the idea. Weighted by interval width. Turns out to be 2 times 2 plus 3 times 1 plus minus 1 times 3 plus 5 times 1, which is 4 plus 3 minus 3 plus 5, which is 9. Okay. And that's great. And what that would allow me to do is somehow figure out some sort of average value of this function across this interval. So over here, the total number of people was 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 1 plus 4 plus 3 plus 1 plus 1 plus 3 plus 1, because that adds up each block of people, and all those blocks together is the total number of people. And if I wanted an average, I would divide by that total. So I could say that the average number is the total divided by how many people there are, which in this case would be 2.05. Okay. In this one, I would say the average function value, I'll call this f of x here, would be 9 divided by 7, because that's the width. So the total which is whatever it is, you know, it's about 9/7. I might need a calculator for that. I've left my calculator on my desk, so I'm just going to go to a computer. Approximately 1.286. Okay. So the average value of this function across this zone is about 1.286. You know, it's sometimes quite a bit bigger than that. It's sometimes quite a lot smaller than that. But overall, that's sort of what it's close to. But it's, you know, it's a lot smaller for quite a bit of the of this interval, and it's only a lot bigger for a little bit of the interval. So overall, it comes out to be about this number. That's sort of the idea I'm getting at. I can figure out an average by sort of adding up what the function's values are, but including them more if they take up more space, and dividing by how much space there are, and so it should leave me with a function value. Okay, cool. But I'm not really mainly interested in the average, really. I'm interested in the weighted total. But it's really just because I'm eventually going to divide by the weight, the total weight, to get the final amount. Okay, so that's the beginning of what integrals mean. But we've got some issues because most functions are not equal to the same value for lots of different, proper intervals. It's not like, yeah, most functions are not equal to minus 1 for 3 whole units of the x-axis. They're not usually equal to the same number for very long at all. And usually they're actually never equal to the same number inside a zone. So I'm going to have to figure a way of applying this to something more. But before I do that, I'm just going to say how it matches with areas, because that's one of the common models of how integration works. So a graph of the function. Okay. So this same function, I could imagine 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I really shouldn't have drawn it there, I'm sorry. I'll just have to move it down a little. Okay. So this same function, I can interpret these numbers as heights and depths, which is how we draw a graph of a function. On my y-axis here, I'm going to go y equals f of x. For everything between 0 and 2, the answer is 2. And for everything between 2 and 3, the answer is 3. And for everything between 3 and 4, the answer is negative 1. And from all the way up to 6. And for everything between 6 and 7, the answer is 5. I'm just going to presume that it's always finishing on an open circle. Okay. So this is a graph of that same function. I've drawn as a height what the number is between these zones here. Okay, that's great. I just should be careful here. I could be, for example, recording the temperature of a piece of wire. Maybe this piece of wire is being heated unevenly, obviously, and in some places it's cold, and in some places it's, well, still cold, but a little bit warmer. And so this height would be temperature, and this would be distance, so something like that. Okay, and then what I'd like you to look at is, see this 2 by 2? This 2 is the height, and this 2 is this width here. And this 3 is the height, and this 1 is the width here. This minus 1 is a depth, and this 3 is the width here. And this 5 is a height, and this 1 is a width here. So it turns out that these areas here are these things here. So this area here is 2 times 2. This area here is 3 times 1. This area here is, well, it's minus 1 times 3. I mean, the actual literal area that's drawn there is 1 times 3, but I know it has to count as a minus 1. And this area here is 5 times 1. So it turns out that if I want to do this sort of weighted average, weighted something, this weighted total, then what I can do is I can add up areas above and below the x-axis. Where the areas above count as positive and the areas below count as negative. And I can perceive this thing that I'm trying to do, where I'm trying to average all these values, as adding up this area and then dividing by the width. Okay. So area with below counts as negative is this weighted total. Okay. All right. So that's what I'm getting at here. I'm just going to color code this the same as what I had before. This time the height here is the yellow bit from the calculation above. And the widths here are still widths the way they were before. Okay. So just to point out that this sort of weighted total is technically, if this really is an area, if this is temperature and this is centimetres, then it would be in temperature times centimetres. And that's all right if you're figuring out an average, because you're going to divide by a width anyway and end up with temperature at the end. So that's okay. So this area here doesn't necessarily represent a real proper area. It may represent something else entirely. Okay, cool. So that's great. I can do an integral, which is now going to be, if a function has just a single value on an interval, then I'm going to define the integral to be that function value times that width. So So this is definition part zero. It's just a lead up to the definition. So it's sort of like a mini definition. All right. If f of x is a constant, I'm not going to use c because that's going to be used elsewhere. Is k for some k on the interval from a to b? It doesn't actually have to be equal to k at the endpoints, so I can use an open interval. This means the numbers from a to b, not including a and not including b, but it doesn't really matter what happens at a and b. It could be, if it was a square bracket, that would be including a. Then, this is what we're going to call it. So the S stands for, it's a stretched out S, but most people call it an integral sign. And it stands for sum. This is going to be k times b minus a. Okay, so we read this aloud as the integral from a to b of f of x f of x dx. That's how we read this. Okay, and the diagram goes like this. If you want to draw it as a graph, there's k and there's, sorry, it might not go, there's a and there's b, and that is the integral from a to b of f of x dx. Now I will explain what the dx means in a moment, but for the moment this is what it means. Okay, and this width here is b minus a, and this height here is k, and the area of that box is this. But just to point out that it would also work if it was negative if k was a negative number, then it would be a negative area. Okay. Right. So that's just, this is the mini formal definition, right? And we don't necessarily need it, but I just wanted to point it out. That's what it is. If your function value is just a single number on an interval, then the integral is the function value times the width. Okay, cool. And what we're going to do is if your function value is lots of different numbers, then you multiply each by their matching widths and add them up. And the ones that are negative will just make the total lower. So what do we do if my function isn't ever just equal to some number? There are two ways of dealing with this. One of them you won't see unless you do a course called measure theory, if you do like a pure maths degree. Later on you may see a way of doing integrals. And that idea is to say, well, let's just figure out how much of the time it is equal to k and just times that width by that. But it might be equal to k multiple times, and that's going to be a bit confusing. But what we're going to do is we're going to do what we did with our chain here. And in fact, we don't really need to worry about different width pieces. What we're going to do is that if our function is all different values at different places, like that, then what I'm going to do is imagine to try and, I'm going to try and imagine that if I was extremely close to this function, then the function value wouldn't change very much. And so I could just approximate it by picking a number and saying, well, on this little tiny interval, it's not very far from this number. And so I could just use that number and pretend it was flat. And so what I can do is I can imagine that this is sliced up into a whole lot of little tiny pieces. And I can, on this piece, if I zoom in, say, just here with a magnifying glass, here's my magnifying glass zoomed in. My function value is sort of going past like this, and here's the little slice that we're doing. On this piece, this area, there should be, if I pick it, a good number to pick here that would be about the right area. And that should be one of these function values that's in this zone. And since this zone is really tiny, it probably doesn't matter which function value I pick. And that's going to be our definition of the integral. The dx that we're referring to is this width here. So we know that to figure out an area, we're going to multiply a height, like a function value, by a width. So the weighted sum is going to be how long it spends being that function value. And if it spends being that function value a very tiny width of x, then it probably doesn't matter which function value you pick. And so what we're going to do is we're going to say that way down here at the x-axis, we're going to say that this point in the middle is the point x, which means that this height is f of x, or depth if it was below the x-axis. Okay. Okay, so what we do is we imagine very large number of very narrow intervals. And approximate the function value with just on that interval by just a single number. And so that means that the integral on that interval will be the width of the interval times the function value, which is f of x, so it'll be f of whatever the middle of that interval is, but the intervals are so small I can just say, well, it's the f of whichever x I'm up to at the moment. And they're very narrow, which are of width dx. And so therefore the sort of weighted total which is called the integral is going to be called the integral from position A to position B of the function value times the width. And this thing here is the area of this slice, only it might not be a real area. And this thing here we add up. Okay, that's the idea behind it. Cool. But you're saying, but David, how do you know you can just approximate it with this number here? Well, I mean, the idea is that this height is not very far away from this height if you're very small, and so it shouldn't really matter which number you pick. But you're right, it's never going to be, how do I know exactly which number to pick? And that number would be the average of the numbers on this zone. And so it's becoming this circular reasoning. Well, how are you going to find the average, David? It's an integral, oh my goodness, bleh. Well, it should be the area, and if I can find a way of figuring out what that area is, a different way, then I could do that. If this was a straight line, then it should be exactly halfway between, because I can take this little triangle and swiggle it around and put it there. And I suppose if you zoom in far enough, it's going to look pretty straight. And so it should be exactly in the middle, which is some nice little reasoning, actually. But also, we don't really know for sure, but we can be absolutely certain that it's definitely less than whatever this highest one is, and it's definitely lower than whatever this, above whatever this lower one is. And even if I was at the bottom of this, it would be definitely above whatever the negative value is at the bottom, and definitely below whatever the negative value is at the top. And so I can start to do it in terms of upper and lower sums, they call it. But just let me, to say it with the area. So this is my new thing. So it turns out that the integral from a to b of f of x dx is the total area to the x-axis with areas above counting as positive and areas below negative. Okay, it turns out that way. Because, function values can be represented as heights and depths. It's not technically equal to a literal area, but I can imagine that it is an area. Okay. So we're doing well. Cool. So it turns out that if I have a function that's flat, it really is just the area of all these rectangles. It's the amount of time it spends being this value times the value itself, and you add up all those things. And if your function is curved, then you imagine that it's just flat. That you can approximate it by a whole lot of little flat bits in very tiny intervals, and as long as there's, sort of infinitely many of them, it'll work out to the right answer. Okay. And it turns out that it gives you the same answer as if you drew it as a graph and calculated the area above all these areas with the ones above the x-axis counting as positive and the ones below the x-axis counting as negative. Okay, so I'd like to just remind you what happened with this thing. We're actually making a running total, and we kept making it higher, and then it went down for a little bit when these people had negative answers, and then it got higher again and higher, and then it went down for a bit again, just a moment, and then up, 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 up. And so that's going to happen if you were doing a running total, then the running total would increase, 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 increase. It would still be getting bigger and bigger here just by not so much, and then I'd be adding negative bits, and so the running total would be decreasing, and then the running total would increase again. And it wouldn't increase so fast here as it does here because the area is higher here, and so it's increasing faster. So I can imagine a function which tells me what the running total is at the moment. And that's going to be an interesting thing to discuss soon too. Okay, so before we get to some fancy ways of calculating this, I'm going to first tell you a way of doing this with... Let me step back. a way of approximating what this area is for a function that you're not familiar with. Okay, so you know how I said here that if I cut it into intervals, it should be possible to pick a number in the interval where it's the right area, because it should be, you know, if it was straight, about halfway between. But if your function's not straight, it's not going to be halfway between. But I can try, I can definitely know something that's definitely bigger than the answer and something that's definitely smaller than the answer. So, this is called approximating with an upper sum and lower sum. Okay, so consider, I'm going to call it g of x, which is going to be x squared plus 3x on the interval from, say, one to five. Okay. Estimate the integral, of g of x from one to five dx. Using an upper sums on, let's pick a number. Eight intervals. Okay, eight equal intervals. And usually, because these intervals are contained in the bigger interval, we tend to call them sub-intervals. Because this is already an interval, and these are smaller intervals inside it. Okay, so that's how a setup of something that you could be expected to do. And the way you do this is you figure out what the function looks like on all of those little subintervals. So the subintervals are, let's see, total width of the interval from 1 to 5 is 4, because it's 5 minus 1. Okay, cool. So the width of each subinterval is 4 divided by 8 pieces, is a half. Cool. Most people would call this delta x. It's a change in x as you go from the end of one interval to the end of the beginning of the next interval. And so this is the picture. Here's 1, here's 4, and we can go, let's see, a half, 2, 2.5, oh, that's 1.5. Look, I'm just going to actually do it with decimals, which is not the preferred way for most mathematicians, but it will be okay, because I'm only approximating it anyway. I'm only supposed to get to 4. 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.4, and then 4.5, 5. Okay. And this is called delta x here. They're all delta x wide. And there's 8 of them. The reason it's called delta x is that a delta stands for difference. And it's the difference of x between one end of the interval and the other. Technically, there's a giant delta x that goes from here to here, but the delta x's here are designed to be the one that's the small difference. Okay, so these are my subintervals. And I can imagine what my function looks like on all of those subintervals. It's 5. Not very good at dividing in half, am I? Now, this function is a parabola. And it would have its zeros at x let me just write some stuff down g of x is x squared plus 3x which is x times x plus 3 zeros at x equals 0 and x equals minus 3 and then it would have a turning point halfway between them because it's a parabola. Okay, so it doesn't turn in this interval. It actually sort of comes down here like that. So there's 0, there's minus. So it, yeah, totally does this. Okay. All right, and the function value here would be what I get when I put 1 into this formula, which would be 1 squared plus 3, which would be 4. And the function value here would be what I get when I put 5 into this formula. 5 squared is 25 plus 15 would be 40. The diagram is not to scale. Okay, and then each of these would have their own function value. And so the idea is that on every one of those intervals, if I was going to do integration the way I've described, I would try and pick a number so that if I chose the exact correct height, that this bit, that the total area would be the same as what I get when I pick that height. But I don't know what the correct height to pick is. But I do know that whichever rectangle is the correct height, it is definitely lower than this number. And it's definitely lower than this number on this one. These are the upper function values for each interval. And the lower values, well, it's definitely, this is the lowest value that on that interval, and everything's above that. So whatever the true area is, it's got to be more than this lower rectangle. So these are lower values. So this pink function that I've drawn, I know exactly how to calculate its integral. The integral of that pink function is, well, what I get when I multiply all these heights by the widths and add them up. Because that's how you do functions that are flat. And this blue function, its integral, is what I get when I multiply all these heights by the widths, and that's its function value. And so I can say that I can figure out an upper height, upper area, and a lower area. It might not be a real area. It might not represent an area actually. So it could be like an upper integral and a lower integral. Okay. And then my function value must be, function's actual integral must be somewhere in between. So in order to figure these out, I'm going to need to know these heights. So I'm going to need to find out what f of 1 is, f of 1.5. And that I will need a machine for. Okay, so f of 1.5 is 6.75 f of 2 Just give me a second. Okay. So this one works out to be 10. F2.5 works out to be 13.75. F of 3 works out to be 18. F of 3.5 works out to be 22.75. F of 4 works out to be 28. F of 4.5 works out to be 33.75. And F of 5 works out to be 40. Good, I calculated them correctly. And so, my upper weighted total will be, let's see. Well, this height here was 4, that's a lower value. And then this one is 6.75. So the lower values will be these ones at the left-hand ends. And so, normally you say area lower will be, let's see, the first one is 4 and the width is 1/2. And then this one will be 10 and the width 6.75. And the width is 1/2. And this one will be 10. That's the one at 2 here, and then 13.75 times 1/2, and then 18 times 1/2, and then 22.75 times 1/2, and then 28 times 1/2, and then 40 times 1/2, which works out to be whatever it is. Whereas the upper area, I did it again, A upper, that's the traditional notation that we use for this. Now that first interval, the highest height there is this one here, which is actually the 6.75. And the highest height here, that's 10. And the highest height on this one, that's the 13.75. And the highest height on this one is the 18. And the highest height on this one is the 22.75 times 1/2, because that's how wide it is. And the highest height here is 28. And the highest height, oh, that's not a 40. The last one's not 40, it's 33.75. Let me just check something in my calculator. Okay, sorry, 68.5. Sorry about that. And then the highest height here is 33.75 times its width. And then the highest height here is 40. And that adds up to 86.5. Okay. And so what that means is that, well, the upper heights, the running total, weighted total of the upper heights, so the integral of the upper heights is 86.5, and the integral of the lower heights is 68.5. And so the real integral must be somewhere in between them. So therefore, the integral from 1 to 5 of g of x dx must be between these things somewhere. Okay? So the question is, so at the moment I've gotten it between 68.5 and 86.5. So it's, what's that? If you went up 2, that'd be 70. So 18. I've got it within 18 of the correct area. Okay? Because, I mean, if I really didn't know anything about how this function worked, other than the fact that it was increasing, it could totally go up all the way and then across this way, and that would be nearly equal to the top one, and it could go down like this and be nearly equal to the lower one. And so the real area could be anywhere in this zone from here to here. I know it's not. I know it's probably close to halfway, but that's okay. Whatever this area, this integral, which in this diagram is an area, whatever this integral is, it's somewhere between that number and that number. Okay, cool. So an important question to ask myself when I'm doing this is, well, how many intervals would I need to use in order to get it to within a certain amount of accuracy? So what if I wanted it to like one decimal place? Or at least to the nearest whole number? Like, what if I needed it to the nearest whole number? So if I got it to within half, if I got these to be a half apart, then I could probably figure out what the nearest whole number would be to the correct answer. Okay? That's the sort of thing that I might want to do. Because it seems reasonable that if I cut each of these intervals in half, for example, then that lower one would be higher and this higher one would be lower, and everything would be closer together. Okay? Cool. And the widths would be narrower as well. So I want you to notice, to watch something. Just give me a second to get a resource. Okay. So the gap between the upper area and the lower area is what I get when I add all these little rectangles together. And watch this. Alright, that's better. This rectangle and 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 this rectangle together make a rectangle of their own. And this rectangle is a half wide, because they're all a half wide, and the height of it is the distance between here and here. Look. Oops, sorry. Scoot that along this way. It's the difference between this top height and this bottom height. And that would be true no matter how many intervals I cut it into. And that would be true for any function that was increasing, like this one. If my function was decreasing, then it would work too. That would be okay. And if my function did turn in the middle, well, that's going to be a bit trickier. Yeah. So I'm not going to worry about that. If my function turned in the middle, I'd probably have to do this separately for the bit that was increasing and the bit that was decreasing. Okay, so this difference between here and here is the same answer as what I get when I go the difference between the top height and the lowest lower height and the higher height, upper height, times the width. So I'm just going to do a continuation for this example. for the integral from 1 to 5 of gx dx, where g of x equals x squared minus 3x. No, plus 3x it was, I believe. Let me just check that. Yep, there it is, plus 3x. How many, I should say, sub-intervals? To estimate the integral using upper upper and lower sums. To within 0.5. Okay. So, these currently I've got it to within 18 because it could technically be anything between here and here. So I want it to be within 0.5, which means I need the difference between the upper sum and the lower sum to be 0.5. So we need the upper sum minus the lower sum to be within 0.5. That's what we need. But we know always, we know that the difference between the upper sum and the lower sum is always, I'm going to need more space for this, we know that the difference between the upper sum and the lower sum is always the same answer as the top upper height minus the bottom lower height. I won't call it height, I'll call it value. Damn it, this is really hard to write in the space I have. The top upper value minus the bottom lower value times the subinterval width. Okay. And the diagram of that is this. Like that, and these areas together are a rectangle which is this high. In our diagram that was 40 and 4, and this width is the delta x. Okay. So that's the idea that's going on there, that's an illustration. Okay, so the subinterval width which is normally called delta x is the total width, which was 4, divided by n, where n is how many subintervals there are. And I haven't told my reader anywhere what that number is, so I'm going to need to tell them what n stands for. Let n be the number of subintervals, and it should be this total width, which was 4 because it went from 1 to 5, divided by n because you cut it into n pieces. And the top upper value was g of 5, which was 40, and the bottom lower value was g of 1, which was 4. And therefore, AU minus AL is going to be 40 minus 4 times 4 over n, which is 36 times 4 over n, which is 36 times 4. Well, 30 times 4 would be 120, so 144. Okay. So let's just check something. When n was 8, 144 divided by 8 would be, if I divide by 2, that would be 50 plus 22, which is 72. And then I divide by 2 again, which would be 36. And then divide by 2 again, which would be 18. And that's the answer we got. They were 18 apart last time when n was 8. That's great. So we need to know what n has to be. In order to make this less than 0.5. In which case, let's see, I could multiply both sides by n and divide both sides by 0.5. And so the n has to be greater than whatever that is. So n has to be greater than 144 divided by 0.5 would be the same as 144 times 2, which would be 288. So if we had 288 intervals, then we would know the answer to within 0.5, and therefore we'd know the answer to the nearest whole number. So we need 288 intervals. Sub-intervals for the integral from 1 to 5 of g of x dx to be estimated to within 0.5 using upper and lower sums. If I was in an exam, I would probably just write, so we need 288 subintervals, and that would be enough. It would be enough to answer the question, and you could go back to look at what we actually needed that for. But if I have time, I would write the whole thing just to remind everybody what I was trying to do. Okay, so where have we been? Let's just, what's been happening? We thought about averages, and we thought about weighted averages based on how many have the same answer. And we sort of applied that to say, well, what if we have a function that's got infinitely many points here along a zone that are all equal to something? And we can sort of think about an average of this, taking into account what the function value is and sort of counting it more if it takes up more space, if more points have that function value. And then we thought, well, doing this total, we could imagine it as an area by drawing the function the way we normally do with heights and depths. And then we sort of defined this weird notation here to be, at the moment, if it was a flat function like that, to be whatever the function value is times the width, which was great, weird, but great. And then we imagined that we could do that for a curved function by zooming in really, slicing it up into lots of teeny tiny slices and zooming in really far and thinking, well, you know, it's pretty much straight here. And so if I pick the middle value, that must be the correct height to get the right area, because it worked for areas for flat things. Why not for these things as well? And that should be the average of what these function values are, you know, because half of them are above, half of them are below, and there's the same amount above as there are below. That doesn't always produce the correct average when you do averages, but it's about right. And so with this weighted total is now the sum of all these little tiny rectangles, which is this rectangles, and that's the sum. And then it turns out that it's the same as the area. And I haven't actually been rigorous in defining what I mean by some of those things. And so what I've done is I've shown you how to approximate it with an upper sum and a lower sum, which is great, we can do that. And we've noticed that if it's an increasing function, the more intervals you have, the closer together your upper sum and lower sum are. And that is allowing us now to actually rigorously define what it means to have an integral. So there's nothing that stops us from having these intervals at all different widths, right? So at the moment in this story with upper sums and lower sums, I've got equal intervals, but you don't have to have equal intervals. But I can always find a highest value on any interval and a lowest value on any interval and definitely say, well, the integral, whatever it is somewhere in between those two answers. And it turns out that you can define the integral to be whatever number is between all of the, that is lower than all of the possible upper sums and it's higher than all of the possible lower sums. And whatever that number is, that is the integral. So I might as well write that down. The proper definition proper, as in the one that the community of pure mathematicians have decided is the most helpful definition in terms of all the maths that's going on in the background. That's what I mean by proper. I'll put it in inverted commas, because you could come up with a different definition and a different community might choose a different one. But today's mathematical analysis community chooses this definition that the integral from a to b of f of x dx. And all upper sums for any collection of subintervals and higher than all lower sums. For any collection of subintervals. And they don't even have to be equal subintervals, but if it's definitely above all the ones for equal subintervals. And so if you can find that the only number above all the equal subinterval ones, and there's only one number that's simultaneously above all the equal subintervals and lower subintervals and simultaneously below all the upper ones for equal subintervals, then that will have to be the integral anyway. Okay, and functions where there is more than one number in that zone don't have an integral. So that's the proper definition. It took us a while to get there, actually, because there's a weird thing. This sort of idea of an average is not so easy when your function is curved. But the idea of an average isn't that bad. Like, I can imagine, for example, when I draw this graph on the computer here, I can imagine looking at this and saying, well, the average value between here and here, it's got to be like, well, it's somewhere between 0 and 4. And it looks like it's, maybe about here, that's about the one in the middle. And the average value on this zone here is maybe about there. It's sort of got maybe a little lower. So who knows? There's more above and below. You can think about what an average value means by just sort of staring at the picture and saying, well, it's got to be somewhere in the middle. And that's the general idea of what we're getting at here. Average values, for me, are the easiest way to understand how this thing works. And one of the quickest ways to find an average value is to sort of do a weighted sum and divide by what the total weight is. Okay, so that's what integrals are. And that's great, but nobody really wants to go through all the process of doing all those upper and lower sums. You could conceivably, if you wanted to, calculate a formula for what, well, sorry, you could conceivably, if you wanted to, calculate a formula not just for how far apart these two are based on the number of intervals, but you could even conceivably calculate a formula for what the upper area and the lower area were based on n subintervals and see what happens as n gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And that could get you to the answer. We don't want to do that every time. And luckily, we've had several hundred years since integrals were invented fill in some details and create some lovely formulas that tell us what to do. Okay. Cool. So before I get to what those formulas are, I would like to just give you an example of something. We can now use this idea that it happens to be equal to the area to calculate integrals using our knowledge of how areas behave. Okay, just before we get to actually finding out how to do this ourselves, I'm going to do a couple of examples of using the idea of it being the same as an area to calculate it. So find the integral from, say, minus 3 to 4 of, let's see, of 2x minus 1 dx. Okay? This is not how you would normally do it, but I'm going to actually say using areas to specifically specify that you have to use areas to do this. So I can imagine what this graph of this looks like and think about the areas that are there. So this is a straight line. So I'm just going to draw the graph of y equals 2x minus 1. Okay, I know it's a straight line. Because anything that is something x plus or minus something is always a straight line. And I can draw it, and here at minus 3, it's equal to 2 times minus 3, which is negative 6, minus 1, which is minus 7. It's not going to be to scale. And here at 4, it's equal to 2 times 4 minus 1. Oh, I did not mean it to go from minus 7 to plus 7, but that's kind of cool. And it is a straight line. And wouldn't you know it, I don't have a ruler, because really it doesn't actually matter if it's exactly straight. Okay, so being a straight line, I know that if it goes up, so this is minus 7. So this is the point 4, 7, and this is the point minus 3, minus 7. Okay, so being a straight line, I know that if it goes up 14 and across, 7, then that means it's going up 2 for everyone across. And so by the time it gets to here, that should be 1.5. But I'm just going to check that. The x-intercept is given by, we're going to solve y equals 0, which means 2x minus 1 is going to be 0. 2x is going to be 1, x is going to be 1/2. Oh, good. So I know that an integral is the same as an area between the function and the x-axis, where the bits below the x-axis are negative and the bits above the x-axis are positive. So the area below is, okay, it's a triangle. And so it's going to be 1/2 times the base, so that's 3.5, and the depth is 7, and the area above is also the area of a triangle, and again that's 3.5 wide and 7 high, And so therefore the integral is going to be the area below, the area above minus the area below, because the area below counts as negative. Half and a half, whoop, times 3.5 times 7, which is totally 0. Cool. So some functions, the integral does come out to 0. Cool. So one more before I finish this first section of integrals. All right. Find a formula for f of x, which is going to be the integral from 0 to 2x of 2t dt. Okay, this looks pretty puzzling, this one. But let's think about this. The variables not being... this x is one of these n's of this. So this is the integral from 0 to x of 2t dt. So that means that I've got a function 2t, and the t ranges from 0 to x. So I have a function, I'm going to call it g of t, to t equals x. That's what I'm interested in, and I want to integrate that. So I'm just going to draw this. So that would be y equals 2t. This is the t-axis, this is the y-axis. And here's 0, and here's x. And the idea is that as x moves forwards, this area is going to get bigger and bigger. And I'm sort of doing a running total, if you like. This is the running total as the x increases. But I can totally do this, right? I know that what this area is. So the integral, so f of x is the integral from 0 to x of 2t dt, which is the area under y equals 2t from t equals 0 to t equals x, which is the area of a triangle, which is a half times the base, which is x, times the height, well, which would be 2t. Okay, so just to be absolutely certain here, the base is x because it's this distance here. And height, well, is 2x because that's the value of this height when t is x. So that must be 2x. I'm just going to pop these on the side here. Because if x was 4, the height would be 2 times 4, which would be 8. If x was 3, the height would be 2 times 3, which is 6. If t was 4, it would be 8. If t was 3, it would be 6. If t was 10, it would be 20. If t was x, it's 2x. So that's a half times x times 2x, which is x squared. Interesting. What I've managed to do is I've managed to create a formula that takes the function value that is a new function which says the running total of this weighted of this area so far, or the running total of this function across the zone as the zone increases and increases. That's kind of cool, I think. All right, let me just do one more thing. Just continued. Uh, use the formula for f of x to calculate the integral from 3 to 15 of 2t dt. Okay, well, I know what it is from 0 to 15 because the formula here says that. So the integral from 0 to 15 of 2t dt, is f of 15, which is 15 squared, which is 225. And the area integral from 0 to 3 of 2t dt is f of 3, which is 3 squared, which is 9. And let me just draw a diagram of what the area looks like. That's y equals 2t. Here's 3, and here's 15. It's this area here. Look at this. This is this triangle. And this is this triangle. And so if I do that minus that, it should be the correct area. So therefore, the integral from 3 to 15 of 2t dt is going to be the integral from 0 to 15 of 2t dt minus the integral from 0 to 3 of 2t dt. That's the two areas that I've drawn, which is 225 minus 9, which is whatever it is, 216. Oh, cool, 216 is one of my favourite numbers. It's 6 cubed. It's the number of options you get when you roll 3 dice. Yay! Okay, so I can use the fact that areas sort of can be split apart and glued together to write this area in terms of two areas that I just created a formula for. And I think that's pretty awesome. And this idea is what the idea of doing integrals using formulas is based on. So the people who have come before us have figured out a way of directly calculating what this formula here is supposed to be without actually using areas. Okay, cool. And I might as well just round off with that, actually. It's going to be a nice place to finish. So, okay, I want you to notice something. See this T here? And you know how it was like T to the power of, say, 1? Well, this x squared here is a squared, which is rather interesting. So it turns out that that always happens, that something that's got a power of 1 will always go up to a power squared, and something that's got a power of, say 3 will always go up to a power of 4, but the coefficient changed, you notice. Okay, and what the people before us, you know, several hundred years ago, realized is that the derivative of this is that, but with a t, of course. So the derivative of x squared is 2x, and that's kind of cool. That's kind of cool. What they noticed was is that the little tiny that if you're interested in seeing how quickly the area changes, that must be the derivative of this function. And the speed at which the area changes is the amount of little extra slice that you add when you move a bit forward. And so therefore, it's the same area as the height, roughly, times a little bit. And so they figured out that if you have a function which is the running total of another function, like the running weighted total, if you have a function that's defined as an integral of something else, a running integral, then its derivative is the function you first thought of, which is just absolutely fabulous. And that's called the first fundamental theorem of calculus. or possibly the second. I can't remember which way around they go. Just give me a second to look it up. This is what Wikipedia says. There's the first part there, and I'm right. Okay, cool. Assuming Wikipedia is good, a good source for this information. So it turns out that if I do have a function that is the running total, that is the area so far as I move this forwards, then the speed at which that moves, the speed at which that function value increases, so the derivative is the function I first thought of. So here we go. The fundamental theorem of calculus. Part one. If you have a function which is the integral so far, it doesn't matter where it starts, like that. So your function is the running total of this one starting at the point A. Then, when you differentiate this function, it's the same answer as just doing the function you first thought of, which is a really cool thing. And part two, is this in reverse. So, if you want to do one of these, then it's just the difference between some other function which happens to be what you get when you do the integral. So you could say that the integral from A to B of g of x dx comes out to be f of b minus f of a as long as f dashed x is the same as g of x. And we did that already. We created a function whose was the integral of my other function so far. That was this thing here. X squared was how quickly this was increasing. And then in order to figure out what the integral was between any two points, I subtracted what the answer to that was at two different points. And that's what I get. Just so a notation. We usually write it like this. Like that, and then we sub them in. So this square bracket thing with the A and the B means sub in the B and sub in the A and subtract them. And you're going, David, that's a lot of information. Like, what? How on earth does that help? And I'll give you an example of using it. The reason it helps is that this works no matter what function I think of. As long as I can think of a function that differentiates to give this answer, that's how I can calculate an integral. So this function here is called an antiderivative. The idea is that I have to think of something that differentiates to give this answer, so I'm doing differentiation backwards. So just some terminology. If f dashed x is called g of x, then f is an antiderivative of g. I shall put that in capitals. Okay, so that's the terminology. And let me do an example. Find the integral from 3 to 7 of x. Well, Jeremiah, why don't we do the one that we did before? The integral from 1 to 5 of x squared plus 3x dx. Let's do it. So what I have to do is I have to think of a function whose derivative is that. Got 5 minutes. So I need to find for x squared plus 3x. Well, I mean, I know how derivatives work. I know that if I start with an x cubed, the derivative will be 3x squared. So that means if I start with a third of x cubed, that should become the thing. So okay, and I know if I start with an x squared, the derivative will be 2x. So if I did this, it should work. Then f dashed x is a third times 3x squared plus 3 over 2 times 2x, which is indeed x squared plus 3x. That works. So f of x squared plus 3x. And so therefore, by the fundamental theorem of calculus, the integral from 1 to 5 of x squared plus 3x dx must be this thing, 1 third of x cubed plus 3 over 2x squared from 1 to 5. Because that's the antiderivative. It doesn't really matter what function I use. I can always, if I can think of a function whose derivative is that, then I can do my integral. And so I'm going to have to do 1 third times 5 cubed plus 3 over 2 times 1 times 5 squared. That's this number. And then 1 third times 1 cubed plus 3 over 2 times 1 squared. That's this number. And so I've got 125 over 3 plus 75 over 2 minus 1 third plus 3 over 2. So 125, so that's 124 over 3 plus 72 over 2. 124 over 3 would be 40. I don't know what that is. 72 over 2 is certainly 36. And 124 over 3, 120 over 3 would be 40. Okay, so I've got 76 and 4 thirds. Now let's just compare to what I got before. That totally is between these two answers. Fabulous. It works exactly the way I hoped it did. And your second video will be about various techniques for finding what this antiderivative is. Thanks.